One image. Same character. Full control. Different camera angles. Looks impressive, right? You've probably seen clips like this before, but what you usually don't see is how fragile that control actually is. That's the part nobody shows. It's where everything slowly goes off track. Here's what usually happens. You change the angle, and it starts to feel like a different character. You try to fix it, and it only keeps getting worse. And this is where most people get stuck. Once you get this right, you don't have to deal with this problem again. And that's what changes everything going forward. But here's the thing. The problem starts with the very first image. That first frame is not just a picture. It's what the AI uses as a reference for the face, for the outfit, for the whole scene. If that first image is unclear, AI starts guessing. And once it starts guessing, you lose consistency.
So the first step is your base reference.
And this is where I want to share something important, because this completely changed my results. Instead of using just one image, I now use two reference images. The first one is a full body image. This locks in the body proportions, posture, and outfit. The second one is a close-up of the face. This locks in facial identity, details, and expression. And here's how I usually get that face close-up. Once I generate my initial reference image, I simply take it and crop out a clean close-up of the face. Even if the quality isn't perfect at first, that's not a problem. I run that face through a restoration prompt that I share inside my academy, and it does a really good job at rebuilding the face, bringing back detail, texture, and clarity. So instead of working with a weak or blurry face, I end up with a strong, clean facial reference. I've tested this a lot, and using two references like this gives much stronger consistency, especially for the face. The model stops guessing. Details transfer more accurately. And the character stays the same across frames. Here's what I look for in those references. In the full body image, the outfit is clearly visible, the posture is natural, and nothing important is cropped or hidden. In the face close-up, the face is fully visible. No shadows cutting it in half, no extreme angles, no blur. Lighting should be clean in both images, and nothing in the frame should be confusing. No hands covering the face, no heavy stylization. Because if the model isn't fully confident about who your character is, every next generation becomes a guess. And that's when you get the classic problem. Same prompt, but a different person. So always fix the base first. Everything else depends on it.
Step two is turning your references into multiple angles of the same scene.
Now that you have your base locked in, using two reference images, the next step is generating a full set of shots. Instead of creating one image at a time, we generate proper camera coverage. I'll show you two different ways to do this so you can see the difference. The first way I use is Nano Banana Pro inside Google Flow. In Flow, you simply select image and choose Nano Banana Pro. In my case, I'm on a paid plan, but even if you don't have a paid subscription, you still get access to Nano Banana Pro for free. But you don't have to use Flow specifically. You can use any app you already have that gives you access to Nano Banana Pro. The reason I personally prefer Flow is because the aspect ratio is much more consistent. In Gemini, the framing isn't always consistent. You might get a square image or a different crop. But even then, adjusting the aspect ratio is easy, right inside Gemini.
Let me quickly show you how to do it. I upload the image as my starting reference, and then I type something like, change the reference image to a 16:9 aspect ratio. Keep everything else the same. And just like that, we get the exact aspect ratio we asked for. Just make sure you're using Nano Banana Pro, because the older version won't handle the aspect ratio correctly.
Now let's get back to turning our references into multiple angles of the same scene.
First, you upload your reference images. Second, you paste the grid or multi-angle prompt. It's a detailed prompt, and I'll leave it for you inside my academy.
For now, the academy is open to join for free, but that won't stay for long. I left the link for you in the description.
Then you choose your output format. I go with 16:9 because it looks cinematic. And finally, you generate. What you get is a 3x3 grid, wide shots, medium shots, close-ups, different angles, but it's still the same character with the same face and the same outfit.
Now, the second way to do this is using the new image generation inside ChatGPT.
honestly, the results here are incredibly good. I've been testing this a lot since it came out, and when it comes to face consistency, ChatGPT does an amazing job. One thing to keep in mind is that ChatGPT does not give you the correct aspect ratio, so you'll need to adjust it using the same method I showed earlier inside Gemini with the Nano Banana Pro model. So the workflow is the same. You upload your reference images, paste the same grid or multi-angle prompt, and generate. Just don't expect it to work perfectly on the first try. It's the same with ChatGPT and with Nano Banana. You'll often need to generate a few times to find the shots that work best for you. And a bit later in this video, I'll show you how to push this even further and get even better results. Step 3 is where you turn this into a real storyboard. If all you need are camera angles, you can stop at the grid. But if you want an actual sequence, something that feels like a scene, this is where you add actions, one per frame. Inside the prompt, there's already a section for this. You just describe what's happening in each frame, step by step. This is where most people overthink it. You don't need to complicate anything. At the end of the prompt, you simply add clear beats for each frame. For example, frame 1, wide shot. She stands alone in the gym, calm and focused. Frame 2, medium shot. She adjusts her gloves, slow, controlled breathing, and so on. The more direct the actions are, the more coherent the storyboard becomes. And honestly, ChatGPT is your best friend here. And here are a few results I got using that exact prompt and describing each scene. Now you need clean, full screen images. You just choose the shots you like and pull them out of the grid. There are two easy ways to do this. Both work fine and just use the one you like more. The first way is very simple. You crop or screenshot the frame you want and then upscale it using a prompt I share inside my academy. The second way also works really well. Because we added numbers to each frame, you can upload the grid and type extract frame number 1. You'll get that image by itself. You do the same for the other frames, keeping only the ones you like the most. Then you upscale it as well. Step 4 is animation. For animation, I used Google Flow.
I really like how the motion looks there. Kling is also a good option, and you can use any app for animation you prefer.
The process stays the same. You don't have to upload each image separately. You can upload the full grid directly into ChatGPT. Because each frame in the grid is already numbered, ChatGPT knows exactly which image you're referring to. You just ask it to go through the grid, frame by frame, using the numbers. Using this prompt, ChatGPT will break the scene down for you and write animation prompts for each numbered frame. You can reuse this prompt anytime. Just replace the animation app name with the one you're using. And from there, you can use those prompts directly to animate your scene. And the final step is editing. All the final assembly you saw, the cuts, timing, text, color, everything, I did inside DaVinci Resolve. That's where I bring all the shots together, trim them properly, add a bit of color, and clean everything up. If you're using CapCut, that's totally fine. You can absolutely do this there as well. I personally moved from CapCut to DaVinci Resolve, and now that's my go-to tool.
One important thing I want to clarify before we wrap this up. This method works best when you're creating cinematic scenes, short films, sequences, storytelling shots, anything that feels like a movie. But if you're working with a single avatar, for example, your own AI avatar, and you want to rotate it, turn it at a specific angle, or control the face direction very precisely, this workflow is not ideal. If you look closely at most videos online that show multiple angles of an avatar, you'll notice something interesting.
Only the avatar rotates, while the environment stays frozen. That's because those results are made using a different approach. I figured out a clean way to do this properly, without breaking realism, and I'll be adding that method inside Academy.
So now you know how to create cinematic scenes from a single image and turn them into something that actually feels like a film. If this was helpful, make sure to like the video, subscribe, and turn on notifications so you don't miss the next ones. I'll be sharing more practical workflows like this. Thanks for being here, and I'll see you in the next video.